Talk with Tracey Marie. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to Table Talk with Tracey Marie. Thank you so much for being with me today. We have a very special show, and I am very excited yet challenged to talk about it because this is something that happens in the body of Christ that a lot of people are struggling with, and they are not able to be open about it or honest about it. So they hide it and they struggle with it silently. But we're going to talk about it and we're going to deal with it today, and that is the spirit of homosexuality. This is the question: can you be delivered from homosexuality? Is that possible? Is it true? Some people would say no, but I'm going to say yes, because I believe that anything that we deal with that is not of God, we can be delivered from, because Jesus Christ died, that he overcame every single sin. So we have a special guest today. His name is Kevin Swinton. He is out of Covington, Georgia, and he is going to be sharing his testimony about what he went through and his personal struggle with homosexuality and how God delivered him from the spirit of homosexuality. Now, I don't want anyone out there who is dealing with this specific spirit to feel attacked, because this is not just about the spirit of homosexuality. It's about spiritual, or shall I say, spiritual perversion, period. Any type of sexual, spiritual perversion, anything that steps outside of what is acceptable to God. So even though Kevin's testimony is about homosexuality, this is going to speak to people who are struggling with fornication, those who are in adultery, incest, anything, again, that is unholy and that is perverted in God's eyesight. We're going to talk about his testimony, and he's going to share his story of redemption, shall I say, and how God changed his life. And we're also going to talk about his new book. So I want you to stay there. Don't go anywhere. We're going to be right back with our special guest, Kevin Swinton, right after this message.
Do you have a Christian business or organization? Are you looking to advertise? Look no further. Here on Table Talk Radio, we offer professional on-air ads for those who want to promote business, church, or community events at reasonable rates that fit your budget. So go to tabletalkradioshow.com or call 267-341-7480. That's tabletalkradioshow.com or call 267-341-7480.
Holy sanctuary, Lord. Son of man, Son of righteousness, King of the earth, for sinners slain. My heart, and I will sing. Yeah, come on, we worship you, King, Almighty God. Oh, come on, sing.
Oh, and my spirit sings, holy, holy.
In the splendor of your majesty, from deep within my spirit sings, holy, holy.
In the splendor of your majesty, from deep within my spirit sings,
and we are back with Table Talk with Tracey Marie. And I have a special guest with me that's in the studio. We actually did this interview a first time, and we were having technical difficulties, but we were both determined that this word was meant to go forth. So we are coming back for a second time, actually. And I have my guest, Kevin Swinton, in the studio with me. He is from Covington, Georgia. And he took the time to be with me today. And he's going to share his testimony. This is the first time I'm actually doing an open discussion. I've always sent questions to my guests beforehand so that they would know what we were going to be discussing so that they would be prepared. But the Lord is doing something different today, and I know that we trust what God is doing. And so Kevin's going to share his testimony with us about what he went through from the time he was a child through his adult life, and how the Lord delivered him from homosexuality. So, Kevin, I thank you so much for being with me today. How are you?
I am doing blessed and highly favored. I am so happy to be in attendance with you today.
That's great. Okay, I thank you again for being with me. And like I asked before, I'm basically going to just give you the floor, and I just want you to basically just share your testimony, starting at how you got to where you had to or were struggling with homosexuality.
Yes. Well, when I was younger, at the age of about 8 or 9 years old, I had was able to spend the night at my friend's house. My mother never really let me spend the night over people's houses. But this one particular time, she let me spend the night at one of my friend's house. He was a young boy like I was. I'd say about 8 or 9 years old. And when I was able to spend the night over the house, I was interested in playing with the Tonka toys and the Transformers and Atari, things of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
But the young boy was interested in doing other things that had to do with homosexual activity. And I don't know where a young boy would learn these types of things, but
mm-hmm.
I later understood that it was the devil that was putting seeds in me at a young age where I was not mature enough to understand what was going on and how to counter what the devil was doing. Not only did that happen the one time, it happened about 4 or 5 other times as a young boy. So, and the Lord kept telling me as in my later years, he says, you have to pay attention to the tactics that the devil was using. He used 4 or 5 different young boys to go ahead and do his work to get you to believe that you are a homosexual young man, which would lead into your later years and your teens and things of that nature. And as that happened, I at the age of 21, I battled through all of these feelings and things of that nature. But at the age of 21, I finally went ahead and decided to buy the lies that the devil was putting on the inside of me. And I began to go ahead and participate in these homosexual activities.
Mm-hmm.
And for 18 years, 18 long years, I was in the lifestyle. I did pretty much everything that you could do. I lied, I cheated, I did all these things. I even tried to get a boyfriend and to get married and get a white house and a white fence and mm-hmm. dogs and, you know, a bank account with a man and things of that nature. But even when I was in that lifestyle, the Lord kept calling my name. And he kept saying, Kevin, this is not who I called you to be. But I ran from it, and I ran from it, and I ran from it. But one day, God just finally delivered and said, hey, Kevin, listen, I'm going to ask you one important question. And this important question was, he asked me, he says, have you ever thought? And I just was like, God, what do you, I knew it was the Lord speaking to me, but I was like, God, what do you mean, have you ever thought? He says, I want you to write your life story down. And I said, God, I don't really know what you mean by this. So, and I would talk to him on and off. I wouldn't read the Word of God. I would go to church here and there. I stopped going because of certain in things that happened with a certain choir director that was hitting on me, which I told myself I'll never, ever go to church again, which was another tactic that the devil used to try to get me to not go and have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. So I said, okay, all right. So I'm watching these tactics, and I said, God, okay, well, what do you want me to do? How, and have I ever thought, what do you mean by that? He says, I want you to think, have you ever thought, do you really believe what the Word of God says? Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow, that's interesting. And I said, because I've always gone to church, but I never really believed what the Word of God said. I didn't really think of it as the promises from the Lord Jesus Christ. And I said, oh, let me take a day or two to think about that. And I was like, well, do I really believe what the Word of God says? Mm-hmm. And so after one or two days, my answer was, yes, I really do believe that. And then God kept asking me further questions. Have you ever thought that, do I really love you? Have you ever thought, who do I really think you are? Have you ever thought, did I ever call you homosexual? Did I ever say that you were a liar, a thief, a cheat, an alcoholic? Did I say any of those things? And my answer was, God, no, you never called me that. He says, I have always called you an overcomer, the salt of the earth, the light of the world, heir to your citizen of heaven. And I said, God, these are the things that you call me, and this is what you call me in the Bible. So then, therefore, he says, this is what I want you to write your book about. I want you to write your book about, ask these questions to the people and ask them, are you really a homosexual man? Are you born? Have you ever thought, are you born gay? And I was like, no, God, there's no way. As I started to read the Bible said I was created in his image. And if I was created in his image, that means I couldn't have been born gay. But what he told me was I was born into sin. So if I was born into sin, that means I am able to be obstructed with the things that the devil is going to put, whatever that may be, alcoholism, being a pedophile, being a murderer, being a hater, unforgiving, just all of those things I'm able to fall into.
Let me ask you a question. Going back to your childhood, you said that these things happened to you around the age of 8 or 9. And what I want to know, because I know a lot of people will generally ask this question, and that is, when that was happening to you, why didn't you tell your parents or tell someone what was going on?
Well, that's a very good question, because when you're having these tendencies and when you're having these issues, there's nobody you can really go to talk to about these things, because number one, you're confused yourself. Mm-hmm. And you're asking yourself, hey, what's going on? Why am I having cravings for these men or these little boys? I'm too young to even be going through this. What is going on? Mm-hmm. So I said, I have no one I can talk to. So it was just me and me alone. And whatever answers I gave for myself, that's what I gave myself, whether they were right or whether they were wrong. Mm-hmm. I had no clue. And there was no way I could go talk to my best friend. There was no way I could talk to my brother. No way I can talk to my parents, my friends, nobody. So I kept it and held on to it all by myself for years and years and years.
Was it because you were embarrassed? Were you scared of, what was it that kept you from telling them?
I was scared, number one, because I didn't want them to reject me. I didn't know what the reaction was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, I was afraid, because I had these strong feelings and I really wanted to participate in what my flesh. Now, you have to remember that my flesh was craving it.
Mm-hmm.
My flesh was being drawn to it, not me, because I am made in God's image. And
right.
From what I understand is, the spirit goes against the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
and the flesh goes against the spirit. But for some reason, when I was younger, the flesh had me more than the spirit had me.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to do anything that would get myself into trouble. And I didn't know what trouble was. I just knew I wanted to do sexual things to these boys. And I didn't know where that came from. And that's what scared me. I was like, I never wanted to do this.
You said something very powerful. You said that, and it seems to be true, because when I've talked to other people that have gone through this, it always seemed to happen in their childhood. And it was something the enemy was trying to put seeds of that the spirit of homosexuality in you at a young age, so that it could literally take root and affect you in your adult life. And
right.
So I just want to encourage people out there that have gone through this, because a lot of people go through this and they deal with shame and they deal with embarrassment because they feel like, what did I do that led that person to do that to me? Was it something that I did that made them do that to me? And like Kevin said, the enemy, and that's how the enemy does, he comes to us in our weakened places. When you're a child, you have such an innocence that you don't understand what's going on because you don't have that spiritual discernment. You don't have that spiritual understanding yet, so you don't understand. So that's why, the enemy doesn't play fair. So just for all of you out there, if this has happened to you and you've been dealing with doubt, depression, embarrassment, or shame because you feel like this was something you bought on yourself, you did not bring this on yourself, you were a victim, you were attacked by the enemy in a very innocent state, and so don't carry that weight on your shoulders and make it and blame yourself. So, I even pray right now that the Lord will remove the spirit of doubt, depression, discouragement, shame, embarrassment in the name of Jesus, because that's what, when I talk to people that have gone through this who are now adults, so many of them deal with that shame and that doubt. And like you said, Kevin, embarrassment because of the rejection that you feel you will receive even from the people that love you the most.
That's right. That's right. And what the devil does is he wants to keep you silent. He wants you to be quiet. He doesn't want you to tell anyone, because if anybody comes and shares the good news that you have more power over the enemy, that the enemy has no power over you, and you don't have to buy into the imaginations that he whispers into your ear. He does not want anyone to know that. So if you keep quiet and nobody knows that you're going through homosexual tendencies, he can have his way with you by whispering things into your ear, and
right.
Nobody is going to say anything that's going to strengthen you. He doesn't even want you to hear about people's testimonies about
that's right.
deliverance from homosexuality, because what does that do? It gives you power. It
yeah.
gives you the realization. God can reveal to you, hey, listen, son, listen, daughter, if I did it for him, her, and that, and this one, I can do the same thing for you. So contact him. Reach out to him. Let him inspire you. Let him exhort you so that you can be like, oh, my God, if God did it for him,
that's
I
right.
know he can do it for me. And
that's
you can
right.
fall on your knees and say, God, I don't know what you did for Kevin. I don't know what you did for him or her, but whatever it is that you do, if you're real, God, present yourself to
that's
me.
That's right.
And that's
right.
all God wants you to do. He just wants you to surrender your life to him. And it's amazing. It's amazing the power. He said to us, I think it's Genesis 50:20, but I could be wrong, but he says he's given us power over the enemy to walk
that's
over
right.
serpents and
that's
scorpions.
Right.
And he
right.
says, and nothing can hurt you by any means. And if you believe the word of God, that's what the book is about also, is do you believe what the word of God says? And if
right.
you believe what the word of God says, when he opened his mouth, these words came from God's mouth.
Right.
And they're promises, and God cannot lie, and he
that's
will
right.
never, ever break a promise. So whenever you open that book and you have God living on the inside of you, you
that's
can
right.
trust and believe that these are
that's
promises
right.
that the Lord will not break.
I completely agree. Kevin, I want to ask you a question also pertaining to church. We
mm-hmm.
had talked about this. We talked about this earlier, and you made a statement that was so powerful, and it literally resonated with me and stayed with me, even after we had gotten off of the phone the last time. And so what I'm going to ask you is pertaining to leadership in church. I was asking you before that it seems like, especially in the Black community, homosexuality is a stigma that is still to this day not accepted. I have talked to preachers. I've talked to pastors who made comments that they would not minister to a person that was homosexual. These were men. I know a lot of Black men out there that have stigmas when it comes to homosexuality, and I don't know why, but we have to understand that in ministry, we are called to minister to all people. We don't get to pick and choose who we minister to, so we cannot be prejudiced against a specific sin because we have insecurities about it. So what I want to ask you is, how do leaders, especially in the Black church, deal with people who are struggling with homosexuality? And not even just leaders, but within the Black church, what needs to be done so that people feel that they can come to church and feel safe to release the information or to release the struggle?
Right. As we had discussed before, it's very important for the church, not just Black church, just church period.
Yes.
That we face these evil spirits in our church. So if we have somebody that we know is a drunk, or we have somebody that we know is a homosexual, and they're practicing and they're going to church and they're doing these things and they're still going to the clubs and they're still drinking, we're making a mockery of our King, of our Lord, of our Savior. Because the people that are watching, they're supposed, and this is what God says. He says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And I said, God, what do you mean by that? I've heard it so many times, but I was like, God, what do you mean by that? He says, Kevin, if I be lifted up, if you live according to the Bible, if you love me, if you follow my commandments, because it says in the Word, if you love me, you will follow my commandments.
That's right.
And so I said, okay, God, he said, so if I be lifted up and I live on the inside of you and you're doing exactly what I've told you to do, your love that you show to the people that are lost in darkness, I can draw them from the love that I put on the inside of you, and those people that are in darkness can say, man, I just cussed you out, I just stole your wallet, I just stole your money, but you're still praying for me?
Yes.
Now they're saying, oh my God, you go to church? Do you go to church? Yes, I go to church. I love God. Yes. Let me find out who your God is. Can I go to church with you? And this is how God draws
That's right.
the people from our love that God put on the inside of us. And I said, God, that's
now,
amazing.
Kevin, talk about the, when you talked about people who are in leadership or in any form of ministry who are still struggling in sin, and you said it was something that needed to be done.
It's very, very important for the church to come together and follow the instructions that the Lord God gave us, which is the 66 books. Mm-hmm. And it says, it gives specific instructions for what a deacon needs to be, a bishop needs to be, a pastor needs to be, a teacher needs to be. And you cannot be a practicing homosexual, male or female, in the church, in a leadership role. Because we are very in trouble. Sorry for lack of better words. We are in so much trouble when we lead the flock astray, away from God. So when when somebody sees me at the church and I'm preaching and it's a great service and I'm dancing and I'm singing, I'm doing all these wonderful things, but then those same people that saw you in church see you at the nightclub drinking, they have lost the will to find out who the Lord Jesus Christ is, and you're in trouble for that because you cannot live a double life. He says, God says, you cannot serve two masters. You're either going to love one and hate the other. So I tell God, I serve you. I love you. God, whatever your instructions are, I'm going to follow your instructions. And whatever I do not understand, help me to understand. So as the church needs to sit those people down.
That's right.
Whatever it is, have a conversation with them. Say, we're going to sit you down until your deliverance. Let maybe sit with the pastor for six months, seven months, a year, until we can work together to get you where God needs you to be. I'm not going to judge you. I'm not going to hate on you. I'm going to teach you. I'm going to give you the word of God with love. But at the same time, I'm not risking the flock because are a good singer or you are a good preacher or you're a good usher, choir director, but you must sit down. And as the church, they don't need to know why you're sitting down. You just have to sit down.
That's right. And Kevin, I want to reiterate, because I want people out there to understand, we're not giving an easy pass on fornication or adultery or any other type of sexual act.
Right.
That does not line up with what God says is correct in his eyesight, which is marriage between a man and a woman.
Right.
But we're speaking to all of that. So that, because this is the thing, and what you said is true, because I grew up in church, and that's what I saw so much of. People could sing because she could sing, or because he could play those drums, or play that keyboard or that piano, or, you know, because they were talented or gifted in whatever it was that they did. We're going to overlook the fact that she's sleeping around and, you know, she can't keep her legs closed.
Right, right, right.
We're going to just ignore the fact that she keeps having babies year after year after year, but she's not married. We're going to ignore that because she just sings so good. Or we're going to ignore the fact that he's a womanizer, you know, and he's sitting up here sleeping with different women in the church, and you know about it. But we're going to ignore that because, oh, he can play that keyboard. He can play those drums. We're going to ignore the fact that we know that he's married or she's married, and we know that they're not doing right by their spouse. But we're going to ignore that because, ooh, he can preach. Exactly, where is God's power being demonstrated? My thing is, if obedience is not lined up with your gift or your talent, how is God being glorified? If you're walking in disobedience and rebellion, how is God getting the glory from that? And like Kevin said, you're sitting up here and you're justifying the sin that you're in. And what you're telling other people is, sure, go ahead and do what you got to do. And whatever God gave you, go ahead and do it. It don't matter if your life messed up. You'll get delivered while you're doing what you're doing. Really?
And you know what? And what's even better is that I'm not speaking about specific pastors. I'm just going from what God has been telling me.
Right.
He's telling me, Kevin, I even believe that he wants me to pastor. I don't know in what form, what capacity, but I believe that that's what my call is. But
okay.
I believe that he wants me to speak on the things that are hurting God's people. Not
that's
preaching
right.
about you're going to get $1 million, you're going to get a car, you're going to get a house, he's going to deliver
it.
You. No. How is he going to deliver me? How can I get delivered? How am I going to do this? How am I going to do that? You mean I can't gossip? You mean I can't lie? You
that's
mean
right.
I can't lie to myself? You mean I can't? Tell the people what they're doing wrong and stop letting these things happen.
That's
if
right.
you see somebody about to touch a hot skillet and you love that person dearly and they're about to touch it, what are you going to do? You're going to tell them, do not touch that skillet. Get away from that stove. Don't do that. You're going to burn yourself.
That's
it's
right.
the exact same thing that the church is looking at. I see you about to burn yourself. I love you, but I'm not going to say nothing. I have
That's
to say
right.
something.
That's not love, because the Word of God says that God corrects those who he loves. He chastises us because he loves us.
That's right.
You know, God doesn't want to see us go to hell. So he corrects us and he chastises us because he loves us. It's just like a good parent. A good parent
yep.
is not going to stand by and see their child go astray. They're going to
yep.
discipline their child. They're going to
yep.
hold their child accountable and they're going to teach them right. So then
That's right.
what kind of a pastor or what kind of a brother or sister are you if you see a sister or brother doing wrong and you say nothing because it's more important to you to be popular or to be accepted or them not
That's
be
right.
mad at you?
That's right. And, you know, and the love of God is actually, it doesn't even, if you love that person with everything you got on the inside of you, which we're supposed to,
right.
We don't care if they're going to be mad at us. We
That's
don't
it.
Care if they're not going to talk to us no more.
That's right.
But as long as I did my job,
That's right.
and I told you, God does not approve of that. Now, you can do whatever you want, but as long as I told you.
That's right.
As long as I helped you, you may not talk to me for 6 months. That's fine.
That's right. That's right.
But as long as the Spirit of God is convicting you, that's all I want to do because
that's
I want
right.
you to make it to heaven.
That's
and I
right.
don't want, if I see you doing something every day, I know that you're in trouble, but if I don't say anything, I know that if you died just in an hour from now,
that's right.
and you kept doing it, you are going to hell. And I do not preach, I do not speak about fire and brimstone and hell
right.
and gnashing of teeth, but the Bible says the wages of sin is death. And if you die
right.
in your sin,
That's
which
right.
is, tomorrow is promised to none of us.
That's right.
So every second that you have, give God glory, give God praise, because no telling when God decides to call your name to come home. And when he calls my name, I want to say, God, take me because I'm ready to come and see you.
That's right. And you know what, Kevin? What you said pertaining to the wages of sin is death, people need to understand that there is steps that are taken. People automatically think, okay, that means physical death. Yes, it does. But understand this also. It begins with a spiritual death.
Yep.
Because now you have no conscience as to what you are doing. You don't care if you're in disobedience to God. You have gotten so caught up in your flesh and that desire that you're spiritual. You have now gone through a spiritual death. You
yep.
have no, you have no conviction about what you do. And then from
yep.
the, from that spiritual death, now you're going into a mental death because now you have no moral, you have no integrity. Now you don't care about who you hurt, what you're doing, how selfish you are. You don't care. Now, this is the thing. Before that physical death where you die, I mean literally leave this earth, there is a first part of that physical death. And what happens
mm-hmm.
is that now the sin that you are in is turning against your own body.
Yep. Yep.
Because
yep.
now, listen, these sexually transmitted diseases and having children, you know, out of wedlock and abortion, all this, where does it come from? It comes from sin.
Yep.
None of that stuff comes from a holy place. It comes from a sinful place. So you're going
yep.
to go through several levels of death before you actually get to the physical death where you leave this earth.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, and I'm glad you said that because what happens is, When you continue to do the sinful things that you know God is calling you not to do, you know when God's talking to you. I don't care who you are.
That's right.
You know when God's talking to you. And God can say, you know what? Since you're going to go ahead and continue to do everything that I told you not to do, and you
That's
know
right.
it's me talking to you, since you've made an obvious decision to go ahead and continue doing, I'm going to give you over to it. That means, and what people don't understand, the scariest thing in the world, they may think that they're all of that and a bag of chips, but the scariest thing in the world is when God takes his hand
off
of you and turns That's you it. Over to a reprobate mind.
That's
that
it.
Means God has nothing to do with you.
And Kevin, let me tell you something. It's a lot of leaders in these churches right now that have been turned to a reprobate mind and they got a dead church. These people are going to church and they are filled with emotionalism. Emotionally,
yep.
because you're caught up in what you see. You don't understand that witchcraft is going on and perversion is going on because you're caught up in the gift. But the word of God says, Jesus says, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. And then what did they say back to Jesus? But wait a minute. I prophesied in your name.
Uh-huh.
Check this out. I cast out demons in your name. Because remember, Jesus, the word of God says, at the name of Jesus, demons flee.
Uh-huh, uh-huh,
so these
uh-huh.
people say, I cast out demons in your name. So what is God showing us? There's a lot of people that operate in their gifts and still not going to heaven because
yep.
their minds are not right. Their hearts are not right. They don't have a relationship with the Lord, and it's based upon their actions and their behaviors. See, when you
yep.
love God, it's just like when we love each other. When you love your mom, you think about it. Now, I know I'm from the old school. Don't talk about my mom because I'll knock you
out. Don't do it. Yep,
okay?
Don't do it.
Because I love my mother, and you're not going to. If I don't talk about my mother, you doggone sure not going to talk about my mom. You understand?
I know that's right.
Don't you mess with my little brother or my little sister. I will knock you out. You understand? Because that's my family. You don't touch my family. Because why? You love them. You know what I'm saying? So when
yeah,
you
I'm so
love
glad. I'm,
go ahead. Go I'm ahead, sorry. Kevin.
I'm sorry. So I'm sorry to interrupt, but the same thing, just like you said, don't you talk about my mother. I will beat you down if you talk
that's
about
right.
my mother, my brother. It's the exact same thing about our Lord, our Savior, our King. Do not talk bad about my King. Do
right.
not do it. And see, we've got it backwards. The Lord died for us. He
mm-hmm.
died for all of our sins. We're not ready
mm-hmm.
to go to war, to go to battle,
that's
spiritual
it.
Battle, on the earth battle, whatever type of battle. God, whatever it is, I'm going to fight for you.
That's
I don't talk about my God. Don't disrespect
that's
him.
It.
I can understand
that's
your opinions and your whatever you're thinking, but do not disrespect my
and what
God. Don't
said,
do it.
Kevin. When you talked about the fact that when you love God, you will keep his commandments. Now, this is the thing. And that's what I was talking about, because the same love you have for your family or your husband or your wife or a good friend, that you would be ready to defend them.
That's right.
And you would never want to do wrong by them because you love them. You can't say you love God and constantly keep doing the very things that you know offend him.
Yep. Yeah, and it's so important what you just said. If you know, if you love God and you know you're hurting God, you have to be like, I have to fix this.
That's
I have
right.
to change this because I know it's hurting God. And when it hurts God, guess who it hurts also? It
right.
hurts you.
That's right. That's
and
right.
when you have the Spirit of God that's supposed to be living, this is how people are able to be in a church doing whatever they want to, and they know it's going against God. They have a spirit on the inside of them.
Right.
But it may not be the Spirit of God that's on the inside of them, because if they can go and be a pedophile, if they can go and sleep
that's
with somebody
right.
else's wife,
that's right.
and the Spirit doesn't say, hey, son, hey, daughter, you can't
right.
do that. You
that's
have to,
right.
you know, if the Spirit is not convicting you, the Holy Spirit, that is, if the Holy Spirit is not convicting you, whatever spirit might be on the inside of you, you might want to check it.
That's right. That's right. And listen, guys, you know, even though Kevin's testimony is about his deliverance from homosexuality, we're touching based on all sexual sin. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Because I've talked to so many people, and they want to heighten the homosexual sin, but they don't want to talk about the other sexual sins. So that means, like I said earlier, whether it's fornication, adultery, incest, rape, pornography, and homosexuality, bisexuality, being transgendered, all of these things are not of God. And you cannot say that you love the Lord and do these things. Now, this is the thing. What Kevin is telling you is that when you trust God, don't you ever believe that the sin will overtake you. You are an overcomer. And when you trust God fully, you better believe you will be healed and set free. Oh, it's a process. The Word of God talks about transformation, and transformation does take time. But when you trust God, you will. The Word of God says that when we believe it, when we trust God, we are now new creatures. All old things are passed away.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and that's
mm-hmm.
just what it is. All old things are passed away. It does not matter what you used to do when you are truly transformed. If we look at the Word of God, you ever notice that several times in the Bible, God would change people's names?
Yes, he would.
Because
yes, he
they
would.
Were no, even though people identified them as who they used to be, God was identifying them with who they are now.
Now. Yep.
And if he did it then, and if he did it for Kevin, if he did it for me, and he did it for everybody else, you're no exception to the rule. There is no sin so great. Go ahead, Kevin.
So we were talking about the sexual things, and I just want to touch base on this real quick, because
okay.
in the book I explained this real quick. let's talk about real quick masturbation. Masturbation okay. is not allowed, okay? God does not allow. It's pretty much what it is it's same sex, you're having sex with yourself. So I I'm going to be very transparent. I was dealing with that for a while. And God said, Kevin, and I asked one of my pastors, because I'm an open person. I just, you know, when I have a question, I just ask it. So I asked my pastor, and the pastor said, well, Kevin, you know what? Well, the thing with masturbation is your mind goes to different areas, sinful areas, and you start looking at things that you really shouldn't be looking. These are sins to God. So then, of course, I watched what the tactic that the devil uses. He said, well, Kevin, when you do it, you don't look at those things, you don't do those things, so it's okay, go ahead and keep doing it. So then I kept doing it, and like, when I was listening to church music or something, I had to turn the church music off. Mm-hmm. I had to stop thinking about God because I felt wrong. I felt right. bad. And one day God said, Kevin, do you know that feeling that you have to turn the gospel music off, that you feel uncomfortable, that you feel weird? He says, guess what? He says, that's me talking to you, telling you that I am not pleased with right. it. And if you keep doing it, there may be some things that I may have to do. So I said, God, okay, I hear you. I hear you. Mm-hmm. So to avoid having that nasty, trifling feeling on me, mm-hmm. I said, I'm just not going to do it anymore. And when I have to do it, I have to call that spirit. And this is so amazing. I just learned this a few days ago. Okay. When I have a bad feeling and I know it's not of God, I have to call that spirit out.
That's
and
right.
I have to speak to it because That's this right. is a spiritual warfare.
That's
so if
right.
I'm having the desire to masturbate
yes.
and it's really strong, I have to say, spirit of masturbation. The Lord rebukes you, and you must leave, not now, but you must leave right now and
right.
never return. Now, this
That's
is the
right.
most important thing that people have to remember. You can't tell that spirit to leave on your own accord. You have to plead the blood of Jesus. You say, you must leave and never come back in the name of Jesus.
Right.
Boom. He must. He must leave because
yes.
in the Word of God it says, resist the devil and he,
yes.
not he might flee from you, or if he feels like fleeing from you, it says, resist the devil and he shall flee
That's
from
right.
you. So when you call that spirit out what it is and tell it to leave in Jesus' name, guess what?
Right.
That spirit has to leave because he can't go
right.
against the Word of God. But if you don't believe it, if you do not believe it and have the faith, the size of the grain of mustard seed,
right.
which is so small,
right.
you can tell any mountain in your life to move over hence, and that mountain, whether it be homosexuality, being an alcoholic, whatever it is, you can
that's
speak
right.
to it and tell it to move.
That's right. Whatever it is, and that's the struggle, whatever your struggle is, like Kevin says, you have the power to speak to that thing. If you have the faith to believe and know that God's word is real and that Jesus supersedes every demonic force, if you believe that, then when you speak that thing, it will come to pass. And that's so powerful. And thank you so much for being transparent about that. There are so many things that people are struggling with out there. We've all had struggles, and,
mm-hmm.
you know, unfortunately, I think a lot of people, because they've been hurt at the church, because the very hurt that they were going through, they were judged, they were criticized. I mean, so many people in the church are so harsh and so critical, like they've never been through anything, like they came out their mother's womb holy, you know? And so many people are hurting, and you need to know that regardless of what it is, God loves you so much. That all you have to do is repent, ask God for his forgiveness, and ask him to help you. And God will.
He will
do it if you trust him. Don't
if
put
you trust
your trust
him.
In any man or any woman. Don't look for them to do for you what only God can do through Christ Jesus. I'm telling you. But, Kevin, as we get to this point, can you please tell the audience about your book and when is it coming out?
Okay, so the book that God has given me to write is called God Ordained Deliverance, also known as G period, O period, D period. because God ordained deliverance. He wants people to know. God wants people to know, no matter what you're going through, God is a healer, He's a deliverer, He's everything you could ever need in your life, and He wants people to know that He loves you so much. Look at it like this. God said, I love you so much that I gave my only begotten Son. He gave Jesus up for the sins of the whole world because He loved us that much. How many of us would give up our child, our daughter, our son for the world? I don't think very many people would do that. So, you know, and this is how much He loves us. And He says, and Tracy, it's so amazing that God is standing right there at everybody's door, not just mine, everybody's door. He's knocking and He's knocking. I mean, He will never leave you alone. He's going to keep coming after you and keep coming after you. It's just amazing how much love God has for us. Just sit and think about, everybody wants to talk about how bad this is and they don't have no money, they don't have this, but you're eating. You have a roof over your head, but you'll never talk about the good things that God's doing for you. You have shoes. How many people don't have shoes? They don't have a place, they don't have food, they don't have money, they don't, but we can't say thank you, God, for this beat up car. It may not be the car that I want, but God, thank you for me being able to get back and forth to work. It's just amazing. We take the gifts God gives us for granted all the time.
That's right. Mm. Now, Kevin, because I know there are going to be people out there with questions, so how would they be able to reach out to you? First and foremost, did you tell us when the book is coming out?
I'm sorry, I got so caught up. Well, the book is done. It's about to get published now. I just had a meeting a few days ago. But there's a couple of corrections that I have to make before it gets published. But it's going to be published on my birthday, September the 8th.
Okay.
It'll be sent out, and I'll get my author's copy a week after September the 8th, which will be the 15th, I do believe. So I'll get the book on the 15th of September.
Okay, I tell you what, so when it's out and you have information on how the listeners can actually purchase a book, make sure to contact me so I can let everyone know. And
yes, ma'am.
So that we can support your ministry and so that you can be a blessing to the kingdom. And also tell the listening audience, tell them how they can contact you.
Okay. There's two ways of contacting me. On Facebook, it's going to be the same on Facebook and the same on Gmail. It's called g.o.d.haveyoueverthought@gmail.com.
Okay.
And then on Facebook, you can get to me that exact same way. Kevin Swinton would be the name, and then if you do the email, it'll be g.o.d.haveyoueverthought@gmail.com. I would love to talk to anyone about any issues that they're having, or any questions they may be having, or what worked for me. Let's open a forum let's talk about these things so that we can help.
Kevin, you still there?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Okay, I hear you now, yes.
Yeah.
I was just going to tell you, spell your last name so that when people are looking for you on Facebook, they know they have the right Kevin.
Okay, the spelling of my last name is Swinton. S as in Sam, W I N as in Nancy, T as in Tom, O N as in Nancy. Swinton.
Okay. All right. Now listen, everybody out there. Again, as I said, I will definitely keep you updated when Kevin's book is out. And I know you've already been blessed by what's been said thus far. So I know that the book will bless you. Also, it was one more thing that I wanted to say, and it just left my mind that fast. It really just left my mind that fast. But no, that's what it is. If you have prayer requests, if you would like for us to pray for you, if it's something that you want to talk about that, you know, you just want to discuss that privately, just you can send a message. Just go to www.tabletalkradio.com. Okay, you can also email tabletalkradioshow at gmail.com. And if you have anything that you send to me, I will definitely share it with Kevin. But again, if you need a, if you just have a prayer request, or if you need to talk to us more in depth, especially Kevin, please reach out. Kevin, I'm thanking you again for being with me today. It's been a blessing, because this is, you know, God's remnant has come forth, and we are coming against the false teachings, the false prophecies. We are standing on God's word. We are standing on his truth. We're not caring about who's going to be mad. We're not caring. Listen, and those leaders who have been doing witchcraft and perversion and rebellion for years are being exposed. So let me tell you something. When you start seeing stuff happening to people in leadership, don't say, oh, that's the devil. No, it's not. A lot of times that's God.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Exposure has to happen, and you're not going to hurt God's children and think that you're not going to reap what you have sown by doing the things that you've done.
That's right.
You understand?
That's right.
People got you. You're going to answer. All of us are going to answer for what we do. And for years, there has been perverted leadership, and God had us praying back in 2013. And he had prayer warriors, and he had prophets, and, I mean, he just had all of us coming together. We were all on one accord. God was bringing us together, people that we didn't even know, but God was connecting people. And, I mean, people were praying mightily. 2013, God was starting to show things and reveal things, and his remnant is here. And,
yep.
Honey, you better watch out, because they're coming strong. And they're not coming. They don't care about, you know, driving a Bentley, okay? They don't care about millions of dollars. They don't care about being famous. They don't care about being a mega pastor. They don't care about large platforms. They are caring about telling God's truth.
Yep. And Tracy, I have to say this because it's very, very important.
Okay.
I don't want people to think that we are judging anyone. I don't want
of
anyone
course.
To think that we're not loving on them. We love you, but we have to say, tell, and share what the Bible says. We're praying
right.
for you. We're going to continue to pray for you. So it's not about judging, because I'm not a judge. Tracy's
That's
not
right.
a judge.
That's right.
But we are to pray and to work and show love and kindness, just as
That's
the Lord
right.
Jesus has shown us.
That's right. All right. Well, Kevin, again, I want to thank you so much for being with me. And when the book is out, maybe you can come back and we can talk about the book and how it's doing. And if God has given you anything else to share with us, please come back.
Yes, ma'am. It was my honor and it was my privilege to be on here to talk on the radio show. I really appreciate that.
Most definitely. I enjoyed it. And again, listeners, I pray that this blessed you. I believe that it did, because it definitely blessed me. And when we talk about God's word and his power, it just brings nothing but freedom, liberty, and joy. I'm telling you, it feels wonderful to be able to talk about things and be free about it and not be ashamed. Don't ever let the enemy. Somebody said something to me, and it's the truth. Satan condemns. God convicts.
Yes, I love that.
There's a difference, okay? So don't let the enemy condemn you, okay? We love you so much. Again, if you just want to reach out to us, please do. Send Kevin an email or me, or you can reach out to tabletalkradio.com, and we will definitely reach back out to you. So, again, listen, don't go anywhere, though, because I have a few more things for you, and we will be right back with Table Talk.
God bless you all.
Thank you so much for tuning in today, everybody, and I truly pray that something was said today that blessed you, that challenged you, and that encouraged you. I want you to know that whatever it is that you are struggling in, please know that you are not alone. There are so many people out there that are going through the same thing that you are going through, and sometimes they feel like they are alone in the fact that they can't tell anyone, they can't be honest about what they are dealing with. Know that you are not alone, and know that there are people out there that love you, care for you, and are praying for you. Please know that there is nothing that you are dealing with that is too great for God to solve or resolve for you. There is nothing that you cannot overcome through Christ Jesus. So I want you to be strong. I want you to pray, and I want you to trust God. That is my hope for you. Trust God. Take each day at a time. Don't try to follow what anybody else is doing. Do what the Lord is leading you to do. And if you fall, do not stay there. Get back up. The battle doesn't belong to you. It does belong to the Lord. But understand that we all are struggling when it comes to dealing with flesh every day and overcoming the temptation of the flesh. My hope and my prayer is that you truly trust God and know that He will help you come out of the situation. He will deliver you from the situation just like He did Kevin, just like He's done so many other people. Listen, the website tabletalkradioshow.com is under construction right now. So if you want to get in contact with me, please reach me at tabletalkradioshow@gmail.com. If you have any questions, if you have a prayer request. Also, if you would like to reach out to Kevin for any more information pertaining to his book, or if you need encouragement or you just have a question for him, you can reach him at g.o.d.haveyoueverthought@gmail.com, and all of the letters are in lowercase. Again, listen, I love you so much, and you know that my hope and my prayer is that you live better, think better, do better, and have better according to God's will and His purpose for your life. Be encouraged and know that through Christ Jesus, you can make it. Love you guys.